children, and I welcome you all to the first class of your 9th standard history. So this is a new face for you, right? You all don't recognize this face. This is a new face, right? So children, I am very happy to tell you that I am your new history teacher, and for the whole year from now and probably for the next year as well, we are going to learn history together. And don't worry, don't make long faces, huh? History is not so boring as it sounds, right? You and I, we all together will make it very, very interesting for you. I promise you. Now onwards, you will love learning history and civics. All right. So children, before beginning with our first chapter, I would like to tell you that what will be our strategy as we are going to study history for this coming year. As you all know that the pandemic is going on, you all are sitting in your houses. Even now we will have to study. I don't know for how long we are going to make these videos and we are going to do such online interactions now onwards. So children, we'll be studying history along with the video lectures, and as well as your online classes will go on simultaneously. You will watch the videos in which I will explain to you the chapter part by part. I have divided your chapters into different parts, maybe in 3 parts or in 2 parts, depending upon the length of the chapter. I will explain your chapters to you in different videos. Talking about the online class, what is the online class for? See children, whatever you don't understand in a video, because a video is one side interaction, you cannot question back to me, right? So whatever you don't understand in a video, that things we will clear it in your online lectures. Secondly, whatever doubts you have, whatever difficulties, whatever queries are coming up, that everything we'll discuss in the online lectures. So with this videos and the online lectures together, we will make this study very interesting, and we will make up the gap that has come in this session because of this pandemic period. All right, children. So I would like to tell you that your 9th standard history is very, very interesting, children. You might be knowing that history is divided into 3 parts, ancient history, medieval history, and modern history, right? So this time you neither have ancient history, that is the Stone Age history, you don't have the medieval history, that means you don't have to study about different kings, their kingdoms, their political systems, their revenue collection systems, nothing. No more complications, don't worry, alright. Neither we have to study about modern history. Modern history is the British period. So what are we going to study then? We are going to study, children, the post-independence history. We are going to study the post-independence history, that is the history which was after independence. After 1947, whatever political developments took place in the country, all that we are going to study in this year's history. Now, coming to the chapter 1. In the first chapter, children, it is, see, this post-independence history we are going to start from chapter 2 onwards. But then what is there in the chapter first? In the first chapter, children, you have certain basic concepts. Basic means really, really basic. Very simple, very easy concepts in this introductory chapter we are going to learn. So children, let's get going. Now, what is the name of the chapter? Sources of History. Right. So, let us come to the title of the chapter. Let us come to the word source. Now, what do you mean by the word source? Children, what is a source? A source is anything, any place from where you get information. For example, nowadays, whenever you need some information, what is the first thing that you do? You immediately take your mobiles and you Google whatever information you want. You Google about that, you get the answer. So what is this Google? It's a search engine, all right. But then what is it? From where it comes? It comes from the internet. Then what is this internet? It is a source of information. It is a thing from where you are getting the information. So whichever place, whichever thing which gives you information is called as source. Alright. So source is a place, a thing from where you get information. Alright. In this chapter, we are going to study only about historical sources. Alright. And the classification of the historical sources. Now children, there's another question tricking my mind. That is, why do we classify things? Why do you think that we always need to classify things? We have a habit of classifying different things, right? From your childhood, you are studying this classification of different things, right? So what is the reason behind this classification actually? Can you guess? Think a little bit. Yeah, there are two things, children. First of all, classifying things, whenever we classify things, the understanding of those things becomes much easier. Alright, I've written here on the board. See, classification, why do we do the classification? Because first things first is understandings becomes very easy. Whenever you classify things, you can understand it very clearly and very quickly. Secondly, second importance is for you people, because we teachers, we teach only once. Whatever we are teaching, we teach it only once. But it is you who have to go through it again and again and again. Alright. So, for you people, when you classify things, when you make different columns and you write the characteristics of the classified things, and when you make a comparative study between two of them, between four of them, between eight of them, then it is very easy for you. You can remember it for a long period of time. So, learning, the study of this classification becomes very, very easy, and it is long lasting. It stays in your mind for a longer period of time. Alright, so this is the reason, children, why we classify things, why we are bound to classify things in every subject that we go through. Alright, so children, in today's chapter, we are going to study, especially in today's lecture, I would like to say, we will study about the sources of history and the classification of those sources. Till here, I hope you are having no problem. Children, one more thing I would like to add here. Along with the listening of the lectures, you will have to do one more thing, one more exercise you are going to go through. Now, what is that? See, children, after the video is over, in the end of every video, I will give you certain revision questions. Now, what are these revision questions? Whatever part I have taught you, from the same part, I will give you certain amount of questions which will have very small answers. I will not give you a long detailed answer of a paragraph to write, okay? Don't worry about that. Those questions will be having a one line or two line answers most probably. So what you will have to do after listening to the video carefully, you will have to read your textbook. I assume that everybody of you are having your textbooks. If you are not having, children, please make them available from the ex-students. So, then you will have to go through that part of the textbook and you will have to find out the answers to the revision questions that I have given to you. Have I made myself clear, children? Alright. So, let us now come to the classification of historical sources. Now, children, very simple. You understood what is meant by sources. That is any place or thing from where you get information. Now, easily you can understand the meaning of the word historical sources. Now, what is historical sources? Historical sources is from where you get the information about history. Very simple. Agar plain information mile to wo ho gaya source, aur agar historical information milti hai to wo ho gaya historical source. Alright. So now these historical sources, children, are classified in two ways. The first way and the second way is written on the board. Children, I would like to suggest, once I finish my lecture, I would like you people to take a screenshot of this lecture. Either you take it at the end of the lecture or you take it at the beginning of the lecture. And in every lecture, please kindly take a screenshot of the blackboard, because this will help you to understand the chapter. Now, for example, if I have divided this chapter into three parts. So the first part of your chapter, children, when you will take a screenshot of the board, do not only take the screenshot, copy it down in your notebook as it is. Now, why is that important? That is important because in one snapshot, you will get an idea of what you have learned. And when you will go through, when you will start learning for your exams, that time also this snapshot is going to help you a lot. Alright. Now, moving to historical sources and their classification. Now, the first way to classify the historical sources. The first way, the time. The time is made the basis on which the historical sources are classified into primary source and secondary source. Now, what is a primary source? See, children, Both these sources I will make you understand with a very, very easy example. Suppose you have a marriage function in your family. Now, right now in this pandemic, you cannot visit that marriage function, obviously, right? So now you are very curious to know about that marriage function. Okay. Now, all of you know that the police has allowed only 20 relatives to attend the marriage function, and you are living far away, so you can't attend it. Now, if you wish to find information about that marriage functions, you have two options with you. First, you can ask any of your relative or the person who is getting married, maybe your cousin, maybe your mama, mommy, uncle, auntie, whoever. Okay. You can ask that person to share the photographs of the marriage function with you on your WhatsApp, right? This is one option with you. You can ask him or her, anybody, to share photographs with you. All right. And the second option is that if this mobile and WhatsApp is not available with you or network connectivity is not there, then what is the option left with you? Now, there is no other option. You have to sit at home and wait for the people who have attended the marriage to come back to their own houses. Why? Because once the people who have attended the marriage will come back, you can call them and ask them about any information what you want. For example, I tell you the first information what you will want to know is that how many dishes were there in the marriage function? What was there to eat? Right? So, and girls might want to know about the jewelry of the bride, about who wore what, which sari, which matching jewelry they wore. All right. So whatever information you want to have, you will have to call your relative who has attended that function, and he will tell you about all the information. Now, I told you two sources from where you can get the information. First is from the photographs, and second is from the narration of your relative. Alright, now children, there is a difference between these two sources, between these two informations. Now, for example, in the photograph, whatever was there in the marriage, you will be able to understand it or to get the information as it is. As it is information you will get from the photographs. But talking about your relative, if your relative is a little bit cunning person, then maybe he or she might not tell you the correct information, might give you certain wrong information, or by mistake can give you certain wrong information. All right. Or can present some biased views. Biased views means his own views he may add into the information, and then he may provide that information to you. All right. Because the relative is narrating to you after the marriage has taken place, but the photographs were clicked during the marriage ceremony was going on. Are you understanding the difference, children? Are you understanding? Please try to understand that the photographs were clicked during the marriage function, whereas the relative is narrating to you about the marriage function after the marriage had taken place. All right. So, the information what you get at the time of the happening of the event is called as primary information. And that is why also it is also called as first-hand information. It is also called as first-hand information because you get it when the event was actually going on. Alright, whereas the narration, what the relative is doing to you, that is after the marriage function happened. So, that becomes your secondary information because that information came to you after the event had taken place. That means the event was completed. It was over. It was finished. That is why the secondary information is also called as second-hand information. Alright. Now, I would like to tell you here that primary information is a more authentic one. Now, what do you mean by authentic? It is more reliable, more dependable. That means these photographs are more authentic. Whatever happened there, the photographs are going to depict it as it is. Alright, so the information from the photographs is going to be a more reliable, more dependable, a more true information than what you get it from the narration of your relative. Alright, why? Because I told you that he may add his views into the information. He may by mistake tell you some wrong information, और ही मे नॉट टेल यू द फुल कंप्लीट इंफॉर्मेशन, राइट? ही मे टेल सम थिंग्स, ही मे फॉरगेट समथिंग टू टेल यू, ऑल राइट? सो यू कैनॉट गेट द कंप्लीट इंफॉर्मेशन. दैट इज वाई द सेकेंडरी इंफॉर्मेशन वी से दैट कंपेयर टू द प्राइमरी इट इज लेस रिलायबल और लेस डिपेंडेबल. नाउ व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट हिस्ट्री देन प्राइमरी इंफॉर्मेशन इज द कॉइन्स. सी एग्जाम्पल इज रिटन हियर ऑन द बोर्ड, कॉइन्स, बिकॉज कॉइन्स आर minted in that particular period when the rule of the king or queen was going on, right? Whereas books, for example, any book is written, any film is produced, that film or that book is written after the event has taken place. For example, recent movie Manikarnika, if you have watched, right? So this movie was produced very long time after Jhansi Ki Rani had already died, right? So maybe this movie will make some changes in the existing information, add something to it, subtract something from it, right? So overall information you may get, but details of the information you may receive correctly or may not receive correctly. Same is the thing with the books, with the biographies, with the autobiographies. All right. So the information which is collected at the time of happening of the event is the primary information, whereas the information collected after the event has taken place is called as secondary information. Now, I assume that all of you have followed the first way of classification very, very clearly. Now, let us move on to the second way of classification. See children, the second way in which historical sources are classified is written sources, material sources, oral sources and audiovisual sources, right? Now, talking about written sources. See children, written sources matlab whatever printed material is there or handwritten material is there, whatever documents are there, all that mold into the category of written sources. So your examples are given on the board. Newspapers can be said to be a written source of information. Then periodicals. What are periodicals? See children, with your newspaper you might receive some magazines which you receive once in a week or which you receive once in a month. All right. So the magazines or the documents, what you receive after a particular period of time, that every Thursday you receive. So after a period of 7 days you receive it, or in a month you receive. So the period of 1 month goes and then you receive it. तो जो पर्टिकुलर पीरियड के बाद रिसीव करने वाले रिटन सोर्सेज होते हैं उनको हम बोलते हैं पीरियोडिकल्स. इन इट यू कैन काउंट योर वीकलीज, योर मंथलीज एंड ईयरलीज एज वेल. सो नेक्स्ट इज पोस्टेज स्टैम्प्स. नाउ चिल्ड्रन, दिस पोस्टेज स्टैम्प इज वेरी वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग, राइट? इन योर नेक्स्ट लेक्चर्स वी विल गो इन द डिटेल्स ऑफ अंडरस्टैंडिंग द पोस्टेज स्टैम्प्स, बट राइट नाउ आई वुड लाइक टू टेल यू, हैव यू एवर बीन टू अ पोस्ट ऑफिस? I think all of you have been once in your lifetime. So there, whenever we post any envelope, any letter or anything, so we use a postage stamp. Now that stamp is of certain amount of rupees, maybe 1 rupee, 5 rupee, 10 rupee. It is as the cost of different postage stamps are different. So you purchase that postage stamp and there are different colors of that postage stamp. There are different themes in that postage stamp. Some stamps have a tiger on it because tiger is our national animal. Some stamps have the poster of Mahatma Gandhi on it because he was our national leader. All right. So these postage stamps also tell you a lot about the history. All right. So they also become a written source of history. Then government gazettes. Now what is this government gazettes? See children, this government, it takes out some orders, it gives some orders to the administration, or it makes some new rules and regulations and it prints it in a form of document, and that document is called as a government gazette. So if we take out the government gazettes of a period of time when there was the rule of Jawaharlal Nehru, so it will become a historical document or historical source of information. So all these are included in the written sources. Now let us move on to the material sources. What are the material sources? Whatever articles you have, theek hai, jaise coins hai, then tools are there. For example, somewhere some excavation is done. Excavation, you know, when the historians go and they dig a place and they find out something from the ground that has been buried many years ago. So whatever they find in the excavations, maybe a kind of pot, maybe a kind of ornament, maybe any article, maybe any stone age tool. All right. So all these articles come in the material sources. And also the monuments. What is monuments, children? The very, very famous buildings like the Red Fort, like the Taj Mahal. These are also material sources of history. Very clear? Now, talking about the oral sources. Oral sources are the earliest sources of information, children. Because in the early days, when people didn't know how to read and write, when language was not invented, that time people used to talk. In the very early days, there were pictures and there were actions. Later on came the talking of the people. And this oral sources of information are very, very ancient, from long times. Like when written documents were not there, when printing was not there, when writing was not there, the oral traditions only took forward the historical information. Alright, now whatever comes in this oral sources is folk tales. Folk tales means the stories which people used to tell to their next generation. In simple ways we can say, jo dadi nani aapko stories batati hai, folk tales, yeah, they can be called as folk tales. Folk tales matlab the stories which pass on from generations to generations. In the same way, we have folk songs. Then we have ballads. What is ballads? Ballads is a song which is sung in the praise of some king. Alright, for example, very famous povadas you might have heard about Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj. Right, so kya hota hai wo povada mein, ballads mein kya hota hai? It is a song which is sung in the praise of a king or a ruler or a national leader. Very clear? Then, proverbs. Proverbs means there is a very famous proverb, children. Hota jiva manun vatsla shiva. Right, when we study about or when we hear about the story of Afzal Khan and Shivaji Maharaj, that time we know that Jiva Mahal was a person because of whom the life of Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj was saved. And that is why we have this very, very famous proverb, Hota Jiva Manun Vatsla Shiva. So, with this proverb, we can understand the whole story because of which this proverb has come into existence. Alright, so all these things mold into the oral sources of history. Now, moving to the latest and the last sources of history, that is audiovisual sources, under which you can say TV. Dekho, audiovisual, very, very easy. Audio means you can hear it, visual means you can look at it. Now, right now, my video, what you are watching, that is an audiovisual source, because at the same time you can look at me, you can watch me explaining all this, and at the same time you can hear me as well. Alright, so whenever from any source you can watch and you can hear at the same time, those sources are called as audiovisual sources, under which TV, different TV channels I have written over here, this History TV, Discovery TV, what you watch, these are very important audiovisual sources of history, children. Then we have different movies, right? Many historical movies are there. Bahubali, very famous, it's a historical movie. Just now I gave an example, Manikarnika is another historical movie. Then we have Churchill, which is another historical movie. We have different documentaries. And we have so many films which tells us about the history of any particular event or about the life of a person. Then, next we have the most famous source, that is the internet. Alright, so children, this lecture we have studied about the introduction of the chapter. And then we have studied about the classification of historical sources. This was the very basic part of the chapter. If you want, kindly take a screenshot of this. I'll excuse you for a second. Alright. Now, at the end of the lecture, as I told you, I have some revision questions for you. Kindly note down that. Alright. The first question. Mention the different sources of history. Mention the different sources of history. Children, I would like to remind you that this primary source and secondary source is not given in your chapter. Alright? So don't bother about this. This is extra information what I have given to you. Alright? Then, next question. Give some examples of written sources. give some examples of written sources. That's it. So for today's lecture, only two revision questions.